Can we talk about driving? Let's talk about driving. You know how in a parking lot, there are places for you to park your car, and then there's a place and a lane for you to drive your car through the parking lot? Can we all agree that we're going to park in the parking spots, not drive our cars through them as if they're lanes? Can we all be on the same page? Let's talk about driving. You know the little handle to the left side of your steering wheel that is just oh so conveniently placed within reach of all five fingers on your hand? Can we all agree we're going to use that to signal when we're making a turn? You know how on the highway, on the freeway, there are at least two lanes. There's a right lane, and then there's a left lane. Can we all agree that we're going to use the left lane for passing only? Can we all be on the same page about that? There's just something about being behind the wheel of a moving vehicle that causes some people to lose all logic and reason, which is a major factor and a major cause for road rage. Now, some of you, maybe you've been on the receiving end of road rage when someone cuts you off, when someone gets upset with you, when someone gets road rage with you. Maybe for others of you, you've been on the giving side of road rage. Hopefully that's a small percentage of us in the room this morning. We're not going to do a raising of hands or anything like that. But for all of us, we all have some bit of rage going on within us. We all have some bit of anger that happens within each and every one of our hearts, but we don't like to call it rage. We don't like to admit that we have anger because we're sophisticated people and we have things semi put together, at least put together enough to show up in public. So instead of saying we have rage, instead of saying we have anger, we say, you know what, I'm just frustrated. I'm just a little frustrated with this or with that. And it's never anything that has to do with us. It's always something that is happening outside of us. Yeah, there's something going on over there that's really made me kind of frustrated. They did something, they said something, they didn't do something that frustrated us. But ask the average person if they're an angry person, and we say, no, I don't have any anger issues. No, I'm not yelling at people at work. I'm not losing my temper on my wife or my family. I'm not throwing anything. No, there's no rage in us. But the reality is, behind the masks we wear, we all carry some sort of anger or some sort of rage. If you dig beyond and dig under this top layer that we use to present ourselves in public, behind the masks that we wear, it can be a different story. Sometimes the anger emerges overtly. Sometimes the anger is in there a long, long time, and then at just the right time and just the wrong circumstances, it starts to come out a little bit like this. For the over six years we lived in California, we lived in the same house, and it was a great area, beautiful area, but we lived in the same house for over 6 years. And in those over 6 years, we had 5 water leaks. I'm not talking like the faucet was dripping or you turn it on and some comes out of the handle or anything. I'm not talking about that at all. I'm talking tear out the cabinets, rip out the drywall, get into the slab, that kind of water leak 5 separate times. It was exhausting. And so eventually we got to the place where we asked the plumber, man, what's going on here? And so he takes us back as he's torn out some drywall, and he points out this tiny micro pinhole in the copper piping of our house. To which my next question was, hey, how long has this been going on? And he said, it's hard to tell, but it's likely been going on for months, maybe even for years. And isn't that how anger works? Isn't that how anger makes itself known in our own heart? We say on the surface everything is fine. I don't consider myself the angry type, we tell our friends, but underneath the subfloor of our lives, behind the walls and the masks we wear, there's some very real and present anger. Unchecked, unresolved, if that anger stays unchecked and unresolved, we are headed for trouble. Now, anger's not wrong, but if anger is uncontrolled, if anger's stuffed, if it's misplaced, if anger's given full vent in our life, then it can do a lot of harm to us and to those around us. The scripture is clear that anger has the potential to shut down God's possibility for our life. And if we're not careful, anger can flood into every relationship that is significant in our life. And make no mistake, anger, if left unchecked and unresolved, will flood into the halls everywhere, all throughout our life. But again, anger in and of itself is not always wrong. In fact, Paul wrote in his letter to the church at Ephesus, in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul says, "In your anger, do not sin." Paul didn't say, "Don't sin by being angry," because anger, again, is not in itself a sin. He said, "In your anger, don't sin. Don't get to a place in your anger where it causes you to sin." James, the brother of Jesus, said it a little bit differently when he wrote, "Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry." James encourages us, be sure that you're listening, that you're present, that you're not just hearing words come out, but make sure you listen, do listening well, and then be slow to speak. You don't have to respond to everything. Don't always just throw out your opinion, and be slow to anger. So anger is not wrong in itself. In fact, Jesus himself was angry at times. He acted on this powerful emotion and yet never sinned. Jesus had strong words for his disciples on several occasions. You may know that if you've heard stories of the New Testament and the Gospels, that Jesus got angry at the money changers in the temple, kicked them out, flipped some tables, and yet never sinned. So Scripture tells us and shows us that yes, there's a time to be angry and a time to rightly express our anger. And yet, this is not the type of anger that we're going to be talking about today. Because there's a lot of ways that anger works in our lives, where it becomes a problem. This is what we want to address. Behind the masks that we wear, behind the smiles that we put on, are some deep hurts that have caused some anger where we just lose control. There are times when anger becomes an issue. Maybe you've experienced anger of these sorts. Maybe you've experienced wrongly felt anger, where you feel angry about something that never actually happened. Or you feel angry about something that you assumed someone felt, or you thought someone did or say, but in actuality and in reality, they never did or said or felt any of that. That's wrongly expressed anger. Then there's rightly felt anger that is expressed wrongly. There's a genuine hurt that you have. You have a right to be angry about something. This is the anger that you have that's valid, but you just express it in all of the wrong ways. The anger that you have is genuine and valid, but the expression of your anger is wrong because it burns bridges. It blows up relationships. It damages all of the people around you, even you. This is anger rightly felt that's wrongly expressed. And then there's anger that's rightly felt that's never expressed, where you have a genuine reason to be angry, to be frustrated. There's something that happened to you or that happened around you that has caused a genuine and valid anger, but it's never expressed. And instead, it's just stuffed. Now, repressing anger, stuffing the anger that we feel, can be one of the most destructive things you can do. It poses a massive health risk to you. Not to mention the fact that you're living a lie. Now, there are a million reasons, a million causes to the anger that we feel, the anger that we carry. And I don't want to just minimize this morning the anger that you feel down to just a simple phrase. But maybe you're here this morning and you feel angry at a parent. You harbor and carry anger toward a mom or a dad. Maybe for some of you it's not the family relationship. Maybe the anger that you hold and that you carry is toward a professional relationship, a boss, a job. Maybe for some of you this morning, you're hanging on to anger that you've been holding on to since the second grade when your teacher told you you'd never amount to anything. Maybe for some of you this morning, you're holding anger toward a neighbor who plays their music too loud, toward a political party or an ideology that you don't agree with. Maybe for some of you this morning, your anger is around your children who haven't lived up to the expectations that you have for them. Anger can happen anytime we feel betrayed, anytime we feel belittled. Anger shows up anytime that we feel overlooked or slighted, and we wanted something, we had hoped for something, and we didn't get that something, we didn't experience that something, and so in turn we feel angry. Maybe you're angry with a friend, angry with a coworker, a brother, a sister, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, an ex-boyfriend, an ex-girlfriend, a coach, a pastor, a priest, a teacher, an institution, a country, a government. Maybe this morning you're angry with God, or you're angry with your life circumstances. Maybe someone abandoned you, or they weren't interested in you. Maybe someone that you cared about was emotionally unavailable to you. Maybe a parent cheated on a spouse. Not only did they cheat on that spouse, but then they cheated on the whole family because now they're living with another family and someone else's kids gets all of the attention that you feel like you ought to have gotten. Maybe for some of you this morning, you're angry because your parent, your mom, your dad is always too busy for you. They're unavailable when you need them or want to be with them. You're angry with the parent because they didn't take care of you. You're angry with the parent because they didn't take care of themselves. Maybe you're angry with your dad because he's too aggressive, or you're angry with your mom or your dad because they're too permissive, or my parents always embarrass me, or my parents are always gone. You're mad or angry this morning at your parents' boss when they lost their job and they were let go. You're mad at the doctor who wasn't able to save your mom or your dad. Or you're mad at God because God allowed an accident to happen that took someone that you loved. Maybe this morning you're angry with a child. Or you're angry with your son or your daughter for ignoring the truth. Maybe you're mad at your dad for putting too much stress on your mom. You're mad at your mom for nagging your dad too much. You're mad at your dad because he always ignored your mom. Or you're mad at God this morning for not stopping the person that you love from hurting themselves. Whatever that is that you would fill in the blank, this morning you're carrying very real anger. Very valid anger behind the masks we wear. And we wear the masks everywhere we go, to the grocery, home, to work, and even to church. And some of you this morning are just angry at everyone and everything. What's amazing is just how harmful anger can be when it shows up. But the good news is that God in heaven can conquer the mountains of sin and anger in our life. That Jesus Almighty in his life, death, burial, and resurrection has already defeated anger. Sure, anger may still be talking to you. Sure, anger may still be taunting you. Yes, anger may still have venom in its fangs. But make no mistake this morning, anger has already been defeated. We're going to see that in a story that may be familiar to you this morning in 1 Samuel chapter 17. It's a story that is one of my favorites in all of Scripture because it's a story that shows us and reminds us that God can defeat anything that's huge and overwhelming in our life. It's the story of David and Goliath. Now, it's not a story of David's anger being out of control, but yes, David likely had a righteous anger, an anger toward what Goliath and the Philistines were doing to the people of Israel. Now, but this is a story about how those who were surrounding David expressed and let their anger pour out in ways that were not right. It's a story of how David's oldest brother, Eliab, expressed his anger. Now, he had anger because they were all showing up to battle every day to the taunting review of a man named Goliath. And then David showed up as God's man to take care of business, to clean house, to get rid of the issue. But Eliab didn't like that because he wanted that guy to be him. Now, Eliab should have known because at this point in our story, by the time of David and Goliath, David has already been anointed king. David has already slain a bear. David has been providing financially for his whole family through being a shepherd. All of this was already known to Eliab. And yet, Eliab gets to a point where he expresses his anger in a way that's out of control. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 28, says this, "Now Eliab, David's eldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men." So David has shown up, he's on the battlefield, and Eliab is overhearing what he said. And Eliab's anger, scripture says, was kindled against David. And so he said, "David, why have you come down? With whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your presumption, David, and the evil of your heart, for you've just come down here to see the battle." Now notice, if you can hear in this story, the accusatory tone in Eliab's voice. He was reframing David in this story based on his own opinion. Now, if we look between the lines, Eliab is saying to David here, "Hey, I'm the warrior. You're the shepherd. I'm the fighting man. I've got all the experience. I'm the oldest brother. Don't you, David, don't you have some sheep over there? I know it's just a handful of sheep. It might overwhelm you, but don't you have a few little sheep over there you need to be taken care of?" And this is where the problem creeps in, because this is what angry people do. Angry people find a way to knock down the people around them. At the end of the verse, Eliab even takes it to the point where he's calling David conceited, announcing that David's heart is in fact evil for what he's doing. And this is questionable territory for Eliab. Because any time we start making accusations about another person's heart, we're entering shaky ground. We don't know what's in that other person's heart. Only God knows that. And when we make character assassinations about other people, even in the name of a prayer request, hello, when we do that, we're typically tipping our hand at what's really going on inside our own heart. We see this earlier when the prophet Samuel first shows up to Jesse's house. Jesse is the father of all of these sons with all of these valiant warriors. Strong, striking, handsome, charming men. Very similar to myself. The prophet Samuel shows up and Jesse begins to parade all of his boys out. And he starts naturally with his oldest, the tallest and the toughest, parades Eliab out. And if you just turn one page over in 1 Samuel 16, verse 7, this is what happens when the strong, the tough, the mighty Eliab shows up. "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Don't look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" And in this moment, the seed of anger was planted in Eliab's heart. He had the choice. He had the opportunity. He could have taken the moment to trust the wisdom of God, trusting that God knows best who ought to be the king of his people, trusting that God knows best what's best, not only for his people, but for himself, for Eliab, Trusting that, okay, God knows that I'm not best suited to be king. God has something different for me in my own life. But instead, Eliab went the other way. He poured fertilizer on this seed of anger that was planted. He cultivated it. He watered it, nurtured it, tended to it, and let it grow and blossom. But Eliab wasn't picked. And not getting picked can be one of the huge roots of anger in our life. Sure, Eliab felt slighted. He burned with jealousy because he wanted the same honors that David had. And jealousy took root. And jealousy is a tough thing because jealousy causes us to compare and to compete instead of celebrating and affirming what God's doing in the lives of other people. Today, you don't have to jump in the boat that Eliab did. You can take an honest look inside. You can take a look beyond the masks that we wear to cover the hurts that we carry and begin to unpack what's happening in our hearts so that we can eradicate the anger that can destroy us and destroy those relationships around us. Now this morning, I'm not going to give you a quick fix for your anger. I know maybe you're here this morning and you think, okay, I just need one of those staple, simple, easy buttons. Let's push the button. I can get rid of anger. But that's not often how it works. Instead, it often works just the opposite. By God shaping our lives and our hearts little by little, step by step. And today our invitation is simple. We're going to talk about a few things and a few ways that we can work on the anger issues in our life. But the invitation is simple. Our invitation is to continually remind ourselves that Jesus has already won. It's to remind ourselves that what God did for us is greater than what anyone could do against us. Because Jesus has already done the hard work. The battle is over, yes, but the struggle still continues in our life. But by God's grace, he has won the victory over anger for us. And he will continue to win that victory day by day by day. We just need to continually link up to what he's already done. We need to continually remind ourselves and communicate these truths to ourselves to remind us what God has done and what he can do in our life day by day. So here are a few truths, if you're taking notes, that we can hang on to in our battle against anger. How do we deal with anger in our life? Number one, we remind ourselves that we aren't perfect to begin with. Now, this might seem overly simplistic, but it has deep truths and deep connotations for our life every single day. Because when we're angry at someone else, we have to understand and remember that someone has already been angry at us. Now, this can be a tricky thing for us to grasp, I realize, because the someone who's angry, who has been angry, is God. And it's hard for us to grasp the idea that God is angry. But it's hard because we misunderstand the wrath of God. We misunderstand because we tend to think of God's wrath and we overlay our human understanding of wrath. And so we just picture God's wrath as God just strutting around the room, shaking his fist at the air, throwing things against the wall. Because that's how we associate human wrath. But God's wrath and human wrath are not the same thing. In fact, the Bible indicates that God does indeed hold wrath towards sin and wrongdoing in the world. That God does, in fact, harbor anger at sin in the life of believers. The things that we tolerate, God doesn't tolerate. The things that we let slip in and creep into our life, God doesn't let creep in. God's wrath means that he can't have anything to do with sin. But God's wrath doesn't mean he's out of control. He's pitching a fit. No, God's wrath is much more a positional wrath than a raging wrath. It's a character-driven refusal to have anything to do with anything that is unholy. God, by nature, being holy, must turn away from sin. Yes, God is a God of wrath, but he's not a God of outrage. Yes, God has fierce anger towards sin that we need to contend with. There is an intense, severe anger that is no gray area, yet it's a positional anger of God's righteous character refusing to be associated with sin. Paul says it this way in Romans chapter 2. Paul says, "But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you're storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed." So let's use this biblical definition of wrath to reframe our cultural definition of wrath. Because using the biblical definition of God's wrath, we're reminded that long before anyone ever betrayed or belittled us, we personally chose to belittle and betray God. And yet, we were forgiven. In my sin, I betrayed God, yet in God's grace, he forgave me. And so, I can forgive others. How do we deal with the anger in our hearts and in our lives? Step one, remember that we're not perfect. Number two, we remind ourselves that God has made peace with us. Now, this second truth is very closely associated and related to the first truth that we're not perfect, and yet we remind ourselves that God has made peace with us. In fact, the prophet Isaiah, when he talked about Jesus long before Jesus showed up in person on earth, he said that Jesus would be a prince of peace. That Jesus, when he shows up to the negotiating table, has the right, has the option to show up at the negotiating table and show us all of our wrongs and show us what all of our wrongs deserve. But instead, Jesus shows up to the negotiating table and offers us peace. Offers us what nothing and no one else can offer us in salvation. But how does Jesus do that? He does it through the shed blood that he poured out on the cross. And so whenever we're angry, we can rally back around to the cross, remembering the cost that Jesus paid for our betrayal. When we're angry and feeling betrayed, when someone hurts us, we remember that Jesus voluntarily, purposely took our hurts upon himself. That's why we talk about the cross all the time. That's why we sing about the cross. That's why we celebrate the cross. Because it's at the cross that God in his holy anger made peace with us. And that is tremendous news for you and I today. That God isn't angry with us anymore. Why? Because all of the righteous and right anger that God had, the holy wrath of God, landed on Jesus. And God's anger has been satisfied. Number one, we're not perfect. Number two, God has offered to make peace with us. And number three, we believe that God is our avenger. I'm not talking Marvel Universe here, so let's just clear the air. We're not guardians, avengers. No, God is our avenger. When we're wronged, our natural response for too many of us, so many of us, is to take matters in our own hands. If you live in the South, it starts with, "Boy, tell you what, we'll take care of that." If you live in the North, I'm not quite sure what they would say, but more than likely it'd be a complete sentence. But God is our avenger, which means God takes care and makes right the wrongs in our life. God makes right the wrongs in our world. And if we believe that, and that begins to take root in our hearts, it changes things for us. Now, the reason we must work out anger in our lives is because it demoralizes us. if you've ever held on to anger in your life, if you've ever harbored that, if you've ever allowed that boat of anger and that ship of rage show up in your harbor and park it at the dock of your heart, you know how demoralizing that is, how defeating that is, how exhausting it is to carry that with us everywhere we go. But not only does it demoralize us, it also diminishes the glory of God. Because it takes God's own rightful declaration about who he is, saying that he's going to avenge all of the wrongs. It takes that and says, you know what? That's not what I want. That's not what I want, God. And it diminishes the glory of God. But if we really believe that God is our avenger, we'd say, you know what? There's some legitimate injustice here. There's some genuine pain and hurt that I've experienced. But God's promised that he is going to avenge what I can't avenge. Too often, the expression of our anger shows up in ways that just pour gasoline on an already burning fire. We lash out at someone. We withhold love or communication or encouragement in our anger from a person. We seek to hurt that person back. But we think our gasoline is going to make things better, but it only causes things to explode. And when we seek to avenge, we only become more bitter and more broken because we can't alleviate what caused that anger in the first place. Can't change people's heart. The way that we righteously and correctly deal with anger is by aligning ourselves with God's justice. God gives us the power to make peace with other people. God is the avenger of all injustice and all wrong in the world. Justice will come. It'll either come today here on earth or in the future in heaven, but rest assured, justice will come because God said it will. One day, God will make right every wrong. And he's going to be more fair about it than you and I ever could be. He's going to be more comprehensive about it. The situation will find true justice, true peace, real reconciliation in ways that we could never do on our own. And for us to surrender and relinquish and give up the avenging to God doesn't mean we're just brushing the unresolved conflict under the rug. It doesn't mean we're ignoring, because there may be some very real boundaries that need to be established. There may be some relationships that never go back to what they were. And giving the avenging back to God is not to write off all of the pain and the hurt that happened. It's not to welcome people back into your life that could be destructive, that could be fuel to the fire in your anger. You know, our release from their wrongful actions, that doesn't come from the outcome. It doesn't come from their response, or it doesn't come from that reconciliation. No, it comes from God. And so, while we're waiting on God's justice, you and I can operate from forgiveness. Paul, a little bit later in his letter to the Romans, says this in Romans 12, verse 14, bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Now, this is completely counterintuitive, completely countercultural. Paul says, when someone comes to hurt you, when someone's design is to be out for you, when someone persecutes you, don't persecute them back. Instead, bless them, do good for them, encourage them, work on how you can build them up. He says a little bit later in verse 17, repay no one evil for evil. When someone does something evil to you, don't try to figure out and scheme how you can one-up them in being evil. No, don't repay evil for evil. Instead, Paul writes a different narrative for us as followers of Jesus. And it doesn't sound like anything that we would hear about dealing with issues today. Our anger says we need to repay the evil. If someone hits us, then we got to hit them back. But friends, that's just a childlike response. We see it in young kids. When they're hit, they strike back. But as followers of Jesus, you've been hurt Okay, let Jesus heal that hurt. You've been wounded. Okay, let Jesus begin to heal those wounds that are in your heart and in your life. You've experienced pain. Let Jesus deal with your sorrow and your heartbreak, because God is bigger and more powerful than we could ever imagine. Yes, we may be hurt, but Jesus is bigger than our wounds, and Jesus is bigger than our sorrows. The things in our world that have been destroyed by injustice, Jesus is able to restore fully. The world tells you when you feel wronged that you set up boundaries with anger and hate, hold a grudge. But Christians, we are called to walk through the world with the heart of Christ. We offer a different model. We show a different picture as people who love and follow Jesus. And so we trust that God is going to do the avenging. Paul said a little bit later in verse 18, he says, "If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." This is the same guy who's had rocks thrown at him. This is the same leader who's been thrown into prison unjustly. This is the same person who's been beaten and whipped within inches of his life. And he says, as far as it's possible for you, do whatever you can to live at peace with each other. How can we do this? We do it by not seeking revenge, trusting that God is the avenger, not me. Number four. The fourth thing in dealing with anger is we forgive. By Jesus' power, we forgive the person we're angry with. Paul says, and we read this a little bit earlier, but Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, he writes, "Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we're members one of another. Be angry and do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger." In other words, if you and I take Scripture at its word, if you and I believe and live what Jesus has taught, then we shouldn't go to bed tonight harboring and holding on to angry things. We shouldn't move on in life, go to sleep, rest, leave the worries of the day behind if we're still holding on to anger in our life. And so, Paul offers a different model. And it's a model that Jesus showed us and exemplified for us. And it's a model of forgiveness. When we forgive, we acknowledge the wrong. But you also don't hold it against him or her. Maybe you wonder how you can do this, but Brandon, that relationship is forever ruined. I don't know how I'm going to forgive them. Or Brandon, we don't even talk anymore. Brandon, that person died. I don't know how I'm going to offer forgiveness. And listen, I get it. There are some atrocious and horrible things that happen in our world, in our families, in our communities. Yes, the pain in your life is great and it is real. Maybe you're here this morning and you can't even broach the idea of forgiving someone. But I'm pleading with you, I am begging with you to let it go. I'm not one who likes little catchy slogans or little cute things that you would put in vinyl that you bought from Etsy or anything like that. But there's some truth in this to let it go and give it to God. It sounds overly simplistic. It sounds maybe even elementary. But we've got to let God shift the tide in our hearts. We've got to release the resentment, release the burden from our back. And the way that we release it is through forgiveness. Forgiveness is simply when we turn to the Lord in prayer and say, "God, by the grace of Jesus, I want you to know that I forgive this person. You forgave me, and I forgive them. I can't hold it against this person because you didn't hold what I did to you against me." Now, I realize that in some of these relationships that they may respond to you and say, "I don't care." You may go and offer forgiveness to them and they may say, "Well, it was your fault anyway. You may go to them and offer forgiveness, and they say, yeah, all right. But it's not just for them. It's for you. And you releasing that so that you're not hanging on to things that aren't yours to hang on to. Forgiveness is a process. Sometimes it's a process that needs to happen over and over and over and over again. But it's a process that step by step, God uses in our hearts to eradicate the dangers that anger brings. Sure, there's going to be some boundaries that you need to establish. There's going to be some relationships, some connections that can never go back to what they were. But there has to be a release. There has to be that moment where you let go of what you're harboring and holding on to. Otherwise, it's just going to cripple you. And the way that we do that is through forgiveness. Number five, finally, we remind ourselves that we're sons and daughters of God. We were chosen by a perfect Father. The identity is no longer what's happened to us, but what God has done for us. Who we are is no longer what happened, but who we are is sons and daughters. We have been adopted by God. He declares that He's chosen us. And one thing's for sure, we live in a broken world. And that gives us plenty of reason to be angry. There are many things that we can be angry about. But being angry and allowing anger to cut the joy out of our hearts are two different things. Living in a flooded house is a sorry way to live. Living with the burden of anger and rage in our hearts is exhausting. Wearing the mask every day to show up with a smile on our face when there's unresolved hurt and anger in our hearts is overwhelming. So sooner or later, we've got to get to a place where we're just fed up and where we're sick of the anger that stays and sticks to our heart. So this morning, are you tired of being mad all the time? Are you weary from holding this grudge all of these years? Well, dealing with anger this morning starts with just letting go. You know, I've just always butted heads with that admonition of let go and let God. But if we're being honest this morning, it's really powerful. It's really helpful. And it's the best way forward for us to deal with this overwhelming emotion of anger. Unresolved anger is deceptive. It causes us to feel like we're in control. We think, you know what? I'm not going to forgive. I'm not going to let them get away with it. I'm not going to speak to you again. I'm not going to do anything with you again. I am going to, by my anger, make you regret that you ever did what you did against me. And it feels empowering. Yet half the time, the other person is sitting on a beach, not even thinking about what they've done. And we're overwhelmed by the anger that we carry. And what we need is to let go of that illusion of control that we're going to get them for how they got us. Friends, there's a different way. It doesn't require us to put on a mask and look the right way, say the right things. What it does require is getting honest about what happened and knowing what's true about what God's already done. This morning, we can begin to deal with the anger, but we have to get our eyes off of them and back onto Jesus. And realize and recognize and remember and remind ourselves that we are held by His nail-pierced hands, that we're treasured, that we're loved. And what God did for us is greater than what anyone else can do against us. And that begins to put us back together again. And it gives us the freedom to live our lives, to run our race, and to bloom and blossom into what God says we can be. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful that in your anger against sin, you chose to love us in spite of our sin. God, we are grateful for the peace that you made with us, not because of us, not because of what we've done, but because of Jesus and what he did. God, remind us in moments of anger and frustration how you've forgiven us. God, remind us when we're quick to hold on to anger, just how quick you were to release yours. And God, this morning, I just pray that you would bring freedom, that you would begin to liberate hearts from the anger that we hold on to, from the anger that we harbor, so that we can live free, so that we can live doing what you've called us to live to do, and so that we can live knowing the peace that you've brought. God, help us to be peacemakers. In Jesus' name, amen.